And related to that, one concept that was new to me when I came to BC, because it's something that is very important in BC forestry, is this concept of a stand being free to grow. Can you talk a little bit about what that means from a forest perspective, and also what it means as far as the implications for management?
Yeah, well, free to grow, and sometimes it's also called free growing. That's actually another popular term for the exact same thing. It's more of an administrative terminology that's used in forest management on Crown land in BC in particular, and it's known elsewhere. It's more of an administrative concept than it is an ecological life stage, let's say. But you can still equate it to this, you know, sort of stage of development of the stand. Do you know what I mean? And so really what free growing or free to grow means is that the desired trees that you want to grow on the site have reached a stage of development where they are healthy and there's enough of them well spaced, mm-hmm. and they've grown tall enough and healthy enough that they're free of other kinds of competition.
And the idea is that if you leave the stand kind of to itself for a while, it will continue to develop in the desired trajectory, and it isn't going to need some intervention.
Exactly.
Is that correct?
That's exactly right. And that's why they call it free to grow, mm-hmm. or free growing, is that, you know, you can not necessarily walk away. I wouldn't recommend that, you know, but we've got a much more certain, sort of future path, mm-hmm. for this stand now. We know that it's reached its regeneration objectives, mm-hmm. so the standards that were set for regeneration have been met.
And my understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that when a timber company gets a lease on Crown land and they do a harvest, they are then responsible to reforest, mm-hmm. that, and mm-hmm. and until it reaches the free to grow phase, and then their responsibility is over or is reduced. Is it something along those lines?
We actually don't call them leases, but there's different kinds of licenses. There's, mm-hmm. quite a complex tenure system, but in all of them, there is that obligation to reforest. And that's right, that obligation for reforestation ends when free growing is achieved. Yeah. I mean, so there really are, depending on the type of license, there may be other kinds of ongoing obligations,
mm-hmm. okay.
What we call a licensee might have. And there are many different kinds of licensees. People think of industry. Well, maybe everything's an industry, but licensees can be, families that have woodlot licenses.
Okay.
They can be communities that have community forest license.
Mm-hmm.
They can be First Nations that have First Nation woodlands licenses. So there's a whole lot of different kinds of licenses. BC,
mm-hmm.
has a really complex tenure system.
Yeah.
But they do all have in common that they're going to have these reforestation obligations. Somebody's going to have to be responsible for it,
mm-hmm.
and that obligation has been met when free growing or free to grow is achieved.
Mm-hmm. So we can't see a very good view of this stand, but can you say what the silvicultural system was, and do you feel like the regeneration that you've got has met the what you were hoping for in this stand?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely it has. So this has definitely reached the free growing stage. And here in this part of the south coast where things move along at a fairly rapid pace, most site series, it is ecologically based, mm-hmm. and the stocking standards, these reforestation standards are based on site series, correct, mm-hmm. identification of the site series. And most of our sites develop pretty quickly, so that we expect to reach free growing between, say, 8 and 12 years,
mm-hmm.
after harvesting. So, here at 15 years, we've definitely reached our goals. If you were to go out and actually do a free growing survey, which we have done,
mm-hmm.
and you actually count how many healthy, acceptable, well-spaced,
mm-hmm.
trees there are of the species that we want, and their height relative to the competition, it would pass.
Mm-hmm. So it's not just an abstract concept. There's actually a very specific criteria,
yeah.
about the spacing and height and competing vegetation. And
yeah.
I know there's something about the broadleaf trees and what proportion of those,
mm-hmm.
that you can have too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. And we broadly call those, stocking standards,
mm-hmm.
and those are going to be, developed by somebody who has qualifications, and they're going to figure out what are, appropriate, and ecologically based stocking standards that are going to meet, long-term objectives. And those stocking standards are going to be set before harvest begins. Okay. That's part of the process of making a prescription or a site plan.
Mm-hmm. And if the regeneration starts and for whatever reason the planting was poor or there's bad weather or something happens, maybe a lot of deer browse, that it's possible that the lessee might need to come in and do replanting or do brushing or do other activities even a few years after the planting if something has kind of gone astray and it hasn't reached that free to grow phase.
Yeah, that's right. It's the licensee's obligation. So they actually have a legal obligation to reach the free growing standards that, you know, that were set in the stocking standard that was, prescribed and applied to that stand. And so, yeah, they've got to put whatever expense and effort mm-hmm. into it is that's necessary to reach that. It is their legal obligation.
Yes, and from a financial perspective, there's a very strong incentive
to do it
right the first time.
Otherwise, it gets very expensive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.